Previously on Demand Wars.
Entering the Demand Throne Room, one will not survive. Demand Wars.
What's going on, people? This is Balaji, and welcome to another edition of the Demand Wars. He's the creative mind behind the flow with shows like Level Up, The Marketing Mixtape, B2B Therapy, Attribution 2.0.
Bruh.
He is the head of content for Hockey Stack. We gotta move. Hop off the bars, hop off the blog, hop off the Zoom, create a mood, create some tunes. We gotta move. Hop on the pod, hop on the talk, hop on the tube. Please help me welcome the one, the only, Obaid. Durrani. What up,
dude? That was freaking amazing. I've never had anyone introduce me like that before. That's amazing.
Nice.
Desert island marketer. You dropped on a desert island, no food, no water. You got $1,000 a month budget, and we need you to create demand for Hockey Stack. How are you going to do that on $1K a month?
So I'm on a desert island, no food, no water.
Yep.
But I have Wi-Fi and $1,000 budget. that sounds like Amir. I'm just kidding. Love you, Amir. Amir would never do that. He'd at least give me water. So, okay.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so the first thing I do, I'm going to document me being trapped on this island. Be like, hey guys, day two, I'm still on this freaking island trying to create demand for this damn company. I'll go buy this attribution software, dog. And so you see me, I'm dressed in leaves that I've plucked from the trees. That would be sick. Maybe it would put Hockey Stack in like some type of humanitarian crisis. But I think we'd overcome that. But one for sure, I would document me just staying there. Like, all right, I'm trying to chop down this tree and I'm making like a hammock or whatever, or I'm trying to start a fire. But all of these things that I'm doing to survive, I would just be filming it and turning them into TikToks and YouTube shorts and, you know, documenting my stay on this island. That would get me the attention and the awareness. Like, holy shit, this dude's really trapped on this island right now. You know, the world could watch and I could just build up the suspense. And like, it would be this massive Hockey Stack plug while like the world is watching, like, will Obaid survive on this island? And so it becomes this entire world crisis scenario where everyone's just like paying attention to me and I'm like, yeah, Hockey Stack. That's gonna be how I would create demand in that situation.
All right, so I have to apologize to the viewers because Obaid has given warnings before. He shared that he loves to daydream, so me asking him these open-ended scenarios could take us just about anywhere.
It's a very good thing to point out. I'm just talking out loud. Who knows, like, where we're gonna end up?
But I love it. Okay, so that was a really creative interpretation of that problem. You essentially need to find ways to get attention first. That's the hardest problem, isn't it? Getting the attention of your target audience. And it seems like there's ways to do that without necessarily spending a ton of money, but it takes creativity.
Oh, first, they have to know you exist. Here's where people really mess up. We all talk about brand awareness and brand affinity. There's a massive gap between someone knowing your brand exists and someone admiring your brand. Right? One of the most important missing gaps is brand association. First, they know you, then they associate you with a specific outcome or a specific scenario. Then, when the time comes, they take action. In between awareness and affinity, or as I like to say, admiration, is association.
No, this is really great. You talk quite a bit in the Easy Mode framework about all content having a purpose. And the way you've defined this idea of brand association, it could make us marketers think, okay, I do need content that makes them aware of the brand. I do need content on the other end that allows them to feel affinity for my brand. But where's the content where I'm telling them this problem, this outcome equals my product? We need to be putting out pieces of content that make that connection.
Yeah. And to take that one step further, creative concepts really help with that. Creative concepts is kind of what is the bridge between talking about your product and associating it with a specific outcome without explicitly talking about the product itself. You know what I mean?
Round two. Fight!
Folks, she's dedicated a career to building strong brands. Brave brands. Brands that connect with people and dare to be different. She spent 10 years in the best ad agencies in London and Paris, working on the world's leading consumer brands. She's now the VP of brand at one of the fastest growing tech companies in the world, one of my favorite brands, Sync, customer engagement platform. And the bottom line is, when this lady wants to get something done, she makes it happen. So please help me welcome to the Demand Wars, Miss Gwen Lafage. Welcome.
Thank you. What an introduction. Love the energy. Excited to be on this stand.
Fantastic. I am thrilled to have you here, Gwen.
Really depends of what I'm selling and who the audience is. If we take an example, which is you're marketing a SaaS product to marketers or to sales, right? And you have one SaaS product. That's the easiest kind of play. You know your audience is on LinkedIn. I will spend a lot of time sharing content and knowledge on LinkedIn. So in the same way we mentioned Sportaro, video explaining what the product are, videos explaining my point of view, sharing my opinions. I would do a lot of that to start creating a discussion around my point of view and around what I sell. Then I would put a bit of weight behind some of those videos to amplify and target them to reach the right target audience and make sure that that content gets larger visibility.
Got it. So that's something that is available and accessible to most marketers immediately. Why do you think that more marketers aren't actually taking advantage of that? It doesn't cost a lot of money.
Well, it's the fear of putting yourself out there. It becomes personal when you do that. Of course, it's a lot easier when you have a founder of influencers in the company that can do it. Maybe some of the marketers don't feel they have that expertise. I will start building some very unique type of content that can attract the right audience. What is the content that people need? To give another example there, again, small company, it's Peer Signal. They first built the content before they even told us what the company was selling. That brand building, or that demand gen, or the smart marketing?
That's a really good example. A lot of times, marketers struggle with, how do I make my content unique? What are some ways that marketers can go from highlighting their unique selling proposition, their value proposition, to actually doing something unique in the marketplace, almost creating a calling card?
Yeah, it comes down to the foundation of the brand, the positioning. What is that story? But defining that positioning is key to the rest, because then once you have that and you tell that story again and again, you can try to get that rally cry around you, right? Which is what some of the demand gen people have done, like the Chris Walker, right? It's like one opinion, I'm going to repeat it on 20 videos and all the podcasts I'm invited on, and start building a community around that idea before I sell them what I sell, right? All of these are examples of smaller companies that are doing it well. Large companies, it's more difficult, because if you're one marketer in like 1,000 people company, it's like, why would I be the one making videos about stuff, right? You're not as close to the audience and the product, and like, so, and they might have several brand products in their portfolio, a lot of complexity.
Yeah, that's really helpful.
Round 3. Fight!
What's going on, folks? This is Balaji, and welcome to another edition of The Demand Wars. Now, we have a man who claims B2B doesn't have to be boring. He's a B2B marketer trying to live to 150 years old.
What?
50 years as a marketer,
bruh.
50 digging for fossils,
bruh.
And 50 for exploring space.
I'm the captain.
Okay, we're going to have to get into that. He's a radically introverted B2B marketer who creates videos every day. How does that compute? He's so introverted, he changed his LinkedIn job status to unemployed just so salespeople would stop pitch slapping
him. Please
help me welcome the never boring, semi-funny, future space explorer, Tim, the two-man Davidson.
What's going on? That was the best intro I've ever heard. You are kicking in. You could be the intro person for every intro.
You think so?
Oh yeah,
that might be my LinkedIn status.
Next year, pivot. You might be able to do some big things there.
I'm liking it, Tim.
It's gonna be LinkedIn organic. LinkedIn organic just keeps going. So much opportunity still. It's crazy what you can do on LinkedIn as a founder, a CEO, a marketing person, and any department.
Now, the question a lot of folks might ask is, what do you do if you don't yet have followers or a following? Actually, there's a lot of people here who are saying, okay, I want to start posting regularly on LinkedIn, but I don't have the 3,000 or the 5,000 or 10,000 followers. It feels like I'm spinning into the wind, but what do those content creators do?
Yeah, I would start connecting with people that you want to talk to. So if you're marketing to marketers, you know, look up director of marketing, director of demand gen, start connecting with those people. A lot of people will connect back. It's just really cool on LinkedIn how people will do that. So I would do that every day. And then I would also look for the creators in your space that are the big people with a big following that have, say, for marketing, Dave Gerhardt. Anytime they post, you can set up like a notification and go and comment in there. Do that every day and you'll start getting a lot more views on your comments. You'll start getting feedback on those comments and you can use those for content. Those connections also help because you end up getting followers from those connections if they connect with you. It's a daily grind, but there's just so much opportunity in those two spots of comments and just connecting with your buyers.
You create a fair amount of video. I've seen some reports that have suggested different types of content attract more or less engagement and visibility on LinkedIn. Are there particular types you would recommend?
I think you need all of it, really. I used to just do primarily text posts. Text versus video, for the most part, does get a lot more reach on the text part. Same with images, like text and images, I do know those get a lot more reach than a video. That said, video is just more personable. People will connect with it better. You might have better engagement. Like the DMs I get, 80% talk about video rather than a text post. So I do think there's a deeper connection that you get from there, but I also think you need both. Because that reach on the text and the image post, you're gonna get maybe more followers and or connections or people like engaging with it. And then when they see your next video, or your next post with video, they might actually view it because they saw your text post. I think, yeah. I really do think you need all of them.
Round 4. Fight!
What's going on, people? This is Balaji, and welcome to another edition of Demand Wars. Now, this man I'm looking at right here fixes the problems your last demand gen agency fixed. He creates unstoppable demand gen teams that are chiseled out of stone. His first marketing campaign almost landed him in jail. Now he does marketing on hard mode in the cybersecurity industry. Bringing that old man yells at SaaS clouds energy, speaking truth to power, calling out the very CMOs he used to look up to, the soothsayer, the BS slayer, the radical candor sprayer, and the candidate for most valuable player, your demand gen therapist. Please help me welcome the Viking white hat hacker of demand gen, Clark Kent Barron. What up, Clark?
What's up, man? How are you? How are you? What an intro. Absolutely unbelievable. First thing I'm going to do is talk to my audience and see where I need to be. Because if I don't have the time, if I don't have the resources, then every single dollar counts. I can't afford to spend that money on new creative that won't resonate, or an ad spend budget on a channel that no one's at all. So the first thing, which is going to cost me $0, is to pick up the phone or the Zoom and start talking to prospective buyers. And our audience. Before we do any kind of marketing, that is step number zero. Because if we're on a budget, if we're on a desert island, I'm going to find a boat to go to other islands where my buyers are and see what they want. Do it. Just do it. I don't care what anybody else says. You're not going to hold me back from being more effective at my job, period. No one is going to sell anything if they don't know their buyers. No one is going to market in an effective way if they don't know their audience. You've got to do absolutely whatever it takes to figure out how your audience thinks. And no one with, if someone tries to hold you back from that, they're very misguided. Do it anyway.
That's the truth. That's the truth. So let's say in the first month, you gain that insight. How are you for the remaining 11 months of the year, that $1K a month, to generate any sort of demand?
So I'm going to see who else is on the island with me at my organization. I'm going to try to stretch that budget by leveraging any internal subject matter experts that are very well versed in the problems that other islands are having. I'm going to work with them to create content that speaks to that audience as much as humanly possible, using the insight gained from having those conversations when I went over to the other islands in the boat. That's how we're going to know where to put that message that'll be in front of the most eyes.
Love that. You're facilitating, getting the insight from the brains of those subject matter experts and delivering it to the audiences. But at what point does this connect to actually generating, say, pipeline?
This is establishing ourselves as a trusted authority in the space. You know, we're not going to ask for anything in return. And then having that conversation internally where we're going to create a piece of content that is going to be the slam dunk. This is going to be what people actually would pay for, that it's so good. I'm a big proponent of the notion that you just give away as much value as humanly possible and ask for nothing in return, so that eventually, on the off chance where I do ask you for something, you're going to say guilty if you say no. One of the biggest problems that we have is that no one knows what the hell we do. And so they just want to lump us in paid. Don't get me wrong. I want my hand as far down the funnel as you'll let me. I want opportunities. I want qualified pipeline. I want velocity. I'm in it to win it. Ride or die revenue. But there are so many other aspects that come along with demand gen that generally lie with other things in it, outside of demand gen. And the majority of those have to deal with brand.
Entering the demand throne room. One will not survive.
Davidson, B2B big, big shout out to the semi-funny, never boring Fruit Ninja of B2B. Definitely follow him on LinkedIn and look into his brand new agency, B2B Riz. Plus, you can catch his full interview on TAC Network. And you might want to congratulate him because B2B Riz won't be the only new addition to the Davidson family for 2024. Thank you, Tim Davidson. And thanks to everyone for voting.
We will rise up and